Okay. When I say the word job to you, there's always an emotion. Could be happiness, sadness, fear. How many of you feel happy when I say the word job? How many, well, I should maybe make it a little clear. Looking for a job. How many, when I say the word, the phrase, looking for a job, how many of you feel basically happy, upbeat? Three. How many of you feel sad? About 10. How many of you feel scared? Right. Most of you. That's what I expected. And my job is to try to reduce some of the fear. And the way we reduce fear is not with psychobabble, but with practical, simple techniques that will work for you, both as a group. And I'm going to spend a lot of time during these 3 hours doing individual one-on-one, what I call workovers. I'll be inviting volunteers to come up here and tell me your situation, and I will ask you questions and whatever, and in, you know, 2, 3, 5 minutes, come up with a next step. And hopefully that will not only help the individual, but help, there'll be hopefully lessons embedded for everybody. I also, handouts are often used as lining for bird cages. But for what it's worth, I guess every speaker thinks their handout is different. I'm like that too. I spent a lot of time thinking about this, and including this morning when I woke up, I found myself feeling like there was something missing, something I hadn't talked about. And I wanted, so I sent it to Danya and asked if she had any chance to, if by any chance she could print it out in advance. And so she did. What this first one is, where it says vetting employers. One of the ways I think you can feel calmer about this thing is that you are, it's not like you are there for the interrogation. Yes, they are checking you out and interrogating you, absolutely. They want to see if you're smart, if you're easy to get along with, if you're motivated, if you have the skills. But I swear, it is equally important for you to be vetting them, to be checking them out. The right metaphor is a first date. That's right, because so many people end up unhappy in the job because it's not a good fit, or they don't like the boss, or they don't like the organization, or it's the workplace culture or something. And so it is really important for you to check them out. Now, I know when you're desperate, you'll take anything. I got it. Many people are in that situation. But not only will it help you to see if this is a job you want, it actually makes you more desirable. If you are checking them out, for example, in the interview, asking them questions, you don't seem desperate. You see, questions seem enthusiastic, makes you seem interested. And so I encourage you to think of when of the entire job search process as a matchmaking, where the two of you are, you're trying to hook up with somebody, well, with an organization and a boss that feels right. So what I want to do, and this is kind of an experiment, I never do the same presentation twice, I want you to take a minute or two to read just this vetting employers little tiny article, and then ask me any questions. I want everything crystal clear. So rather than going over what's in this article and boring you, that would go slow, take your time. If you've got a question, I want to answer it. Okay. Does anybody have a question? It could be a rational question, it could be an emotional question, anything related to this. Maybe you don't feel you could do it, you have the guts to do it, or maybe it's not clear, or maybe you want something fleshed out. What's the question you have? Yes. That's absolutely correct that everybody's on their best behavior. It has been said that a job interview is two people lying to each other. But all one can ever do in life, whether it be in finding a romantic partner, improving your health, finding a job, is improving your odds. And so by, instead of, most job seekers in the interview are so worried about themselves and how they're coming off. Is my hair good? Am I sounding stupid? Am I, you know, going too fast? Am I this? Am I leaning forward right? Am I that? That they're not paying attention to they're not evaluating the boss. They're not evaluating. When you walk in, you can feel, I know this sounds touchy-feely, but you can feel a vibe in an office. The way the receptionist greets you, the way the other workers, if it's in the workplace, you're walking and seeing the way they're, you know, do they look unhappy? Look, they say the eyes are the windows to the soul. If you look between somebody's eyes, especially if they're over age 40, you wear your person because your skin elasticity is not as good. You actually read what's going on in a person by looking at them. So try to get out of your own egotism and yourself and be a detective when you're going in there. Yes, I want you to be good. I don't want you to be phony. I want you to be your best self. But I also want you to check them out just as you would on a first date. That's empowering also. Instead of feeling like you're this, you know, just this piece of meat that they're checking out, do they want to buy you or not? Yeah. Absolutely. Great question. If anybody didn't hear it, do you want to make sure we be giving the microphone to?
I think so, because otherwise for the video you can't hear.
Awesome. Great idea. So I'll just repeat for now. I'll repeat his question. Then in the future, if you wouldn't mind going to the question. The questioner is, how could you do that in a phone interview? So, you know, of course, you don't want to take control of the phone interview. That's too aggressive, of course. But look for opportunities to ask what appears to be a follow-up question in context. So if she, you know, typically the phone interviewer is going to ask you about, you know, they typically go through your resume on the phone. And so they've said, well, tell me about your experience at, you know, why did you leave this company or whatever? So you give the answer and you say, well, the work was very circumscribed and the project was over and so I left. And that was pretty much the orientation of that office. Tell me about this job. Is this very much that way? Is this likely to be truly very project-oriented? And then it's, you know, is this job temp to perm, or are most of the jobs temp to perm? How permanent are they? So asking a follow-up question in context is the way to do it. Not out of left field. Just listen your butt off. When you are in a phone interview, and of course in person as well, listen your butt off to what they're saying and seeing if there's a way to make it more of a conversation. Now, in unionized environments, you're not allowed to, because the union insists they don't want anything to be racist, sexist, whatever, so that they ask exactly the same questions of every employee, and you don't have a chance to ask questions until the end. But in many other workplaces, you have more flexibility. And in those non-rigid situations, you do want to look for opportunities to ask a question or make a comment so that it becomes more of a conversation. That's how chemistry gets built. If you just sit there like a target, when they're going to bombard you with questions and you answer and then you sit and wait, no chemistry gets created and you look desperate, you look weak. I'm not asking you to be phony, I'm not asking you to be aggressive, but I'm asking you to try where possible to be really fully engaging, and it could consume them. Yes. Let's wait for the microphone.
Morning. My name is Susan, and to build rapport on a phone interview, oftentimes you get the HR recruiter initially.
Correct.
And it's almost uncanny whether the third question, the second, or the first, it always cuts straight to what's your compensation requirements? How do you build rapport, segue? How do you answer that without getting cornered? Because oftentimes, if you really tell them your compensation requirements, you're put in the out bucket or the delete bucket.
Yeah, let's talk about that. First of all, really well-trained interviewers are trained to ask you that early on because they know that gives them huge power over you. If you give too low a number, they're going to lowball you. Give too a higher number, they're probably going to get rid of you. So there are sometimes if they ask it early enough, you can't preempt it. But let's say that's the worst case. So they ask. They'll say, the typical good answer is, well, it depends on the nature of the position. Tell me a little more about the job. What is the salary range that's been budgeted for the position? Throw it back to her. Don't answer that question because you're in trouble. But there's a better solution. If she doesn't ask it right away, as soon as you've given an answer to one of her questions that seems good, say, oh, by the way, what is the salary range that's been budgeted for the position? I want to make sure we're in the ballpark. That throws, uses the same tactic but throws it back on her.
But then sometimes they'll throw it back, what are your requirements, salary requirements?
Well, you know, then say, you know, if you're for, if they really go all the way and they go back to you, then you say, well, if you don't want to wait until I hear more about the position, then I can only give you a fairly wide range. It's between somewhere between 70 and 95, depending upon the nature of the position. So you give her a wide range. But usually they don't go quite that far. But there is a way to give you the power in that situation.
Thank you.
Yep. Any other questions about this little handout? Questions are good. Yes. Wait, let's wait for the microphone.
One of your suggestions is to get to the snack room or workplace where other employees hang out. How do you suggest doing that when you're in the building, but you've been taken to a small conference room for the interview?
It's after this is when I wrote. What I wrote was after you offered the job and before you've accepted it. They write you a note or call you to tell you they're offering you the job. Say I'm pleased, not delighted. You don't want to give away your power. I'm pleased. Can we set up a time for me to come in to talk, discuss terms, and for you to kind of take a look at the workplace? Then you come in, and then maybe you, either before you've negotiated terms or whatever, usually, mind if I get hang out in the break room for a few minutes, have a cup of coffee or whatever? That gives you nothing. We are humans. We're not electrons. So we don't behave completely predictably. But very often, there are opportunities when you're offered the job to visit the break room for a few minutes. Yes.
Yeah, I've only arrived. I hope it's on the subject, but it's about work. How do you develop a voice where you can, go on the radio and talk, have a talk show, and, take over Uncle Ray's midnight shift on the weekends?
The reality is that there's no money in radio whatsoever. I am not a huge fan. I've been doing my show for 26 years. I know a fair amount about career stuff. I know how to do radio. And I bring in a ton of money for NPR, and I get paid zero. My salary is zero. So, and even when I was on KGO, a disgustingly over-commercialized station, I got paid next to nothing. Radio is a hobby. Unfortunately, since the 60s, there has been the message, do what you love and the money will follow. And that generally means creative activities, whether it be fashion or writing or singing or comedy or radio or TV or whatever it is. And so there are 10 zillion people wanting to do some creative activity like that. And so supply and demand means they don't have to pay. If you want to be an accountant, they'll pay because there aren't 10 zillion people whose passion is to be an accountant. So you must do what you love, but you can't expect to get paid for it. I love playing the piano, and actually I'm going to take a break. I'll answer your question in a minute. When we take a break, I'm going to play the piano for you. I love to play the piano. And I did, as a teenager, make a living at it, a good living at it, actually. But not that good, and it would have been a mistake to try to do that my whole life. So do what I love writing. I've written 4 screenplays. I've written 2 plays. I've written a one-woman show. I play the piano for the show. I act in the show. But I don't get any money for it. So I get to do the coolest things in the world. Write screenplays, do radio shows. I've been on, all that stuff. And the key is not expecting to get paid. Realize that what Bill Gates did. He realizes you got to make money where money is to be made. I mean, if you're Barbara Streisand, yes, you're the best in the world and you're going to get paid. But unless you are clearly superior, you're facing lottery odds. You know how many comedians go to the punchline and make $50 and struggle, and they're, you know, living with four roommates at age 50? That you don't see. You see who goes on Oprah. Well, just follow your dream. But as the promo for this talk is, I don't want to see you in Section 8 housing and having to cut your medication in half because you can't afford the whole pill. So nobody cares more about creativity than me. Nobody. I've written 3,000 articles. But even though I've written 550 articles for Psychology Today, I get paid a little. The average, I would say I make about $1 an article. That's the truth. $1. I've written 20 essays for Time's ideas section in the last year. What was my total pay? Time magazine, online, time.com. Zero. And it's not that I'm shy. It's not that I'm afraid to negotiate. It's not that I don't know how to negotiate. Everybody wants to do creative stuff. Everybody. Everybody wants to be a filmmaker. Everybody wants to, you know, work in Hollywood, Broadway. So yeah, the stars get money. But it's really lottery odds. If my son or daughter were 18 or 20 and were saying, Daddy, I have to be an actor. That's who I am. I'd rather have four roommates and eat ramen and cat food, but I want to be an actor. I'd say, fine, circle a date on your calendar. Give it your all, because there's going to be 10 million others who want to do it. Kill yourself for 3 years, 5 years, while you don't have a mortgage, you don't have kids, you don't have anything. Follow your dream so you get it out of your system. Or maybe you'll be one of the ones who wins. Great. If you win, I'll be there cheering you on opening night. But, you know, it's like the balance between keep your head in the clouds but your feet on the ground. That's my message. Any more questions? Yeah.
So this is to the second point in the article, read between the lines of advertised jobs.
Right.
And the question is, what clues should we be looking for, good and bad, in a posting, and how do we figure out what clues are meaningful to us, good and bad?
Well, what's meaningful to you is, of course, going to be individual. But clearly, sometimes if you've got a job description that has got 30 items on it, covering everything under the sun, you know what that says? It says the organization sucks. It means the decision-making is made by committee, and nobody can agree on everything is by consensus. So they say, we'll just throw everything in the kitchen sink. That's a lousy organization. It's not crisp, and it's not respect. If they ask also for you to do too much, I worry a lot about job applications where they make you come in. We want you to do a market, it's a marketing job. We require applicants to submit a proposal for how you would market our business. All that does, it really shows how unfair they are to the employee, because they're asking you to do all of this work for free merely so they can get free consulting. They may not even hire anybody. So they need to show a measure of respect for the candidates. So also, are they being unrealistic? They may only have 5 or 6 items in the job description, but if they're asking for Jesus incarnate, no good. So you read between the lines, and there are buzzwords, as I wrote in that little article. Self-starter, fast-paced, high energy, exciting environment, that says 12 hours a day, no breaks. So again, we're dealing with human beings, not electrons, so there's no 100% guarantee, but you get a feeling about the place. Now, of course, sometimes they hire some HR person who's a nice, soft, touchy-feely person who writes a lovely little ad that makes you feel welcoming and wonderful. So that's why I've got 5 steps in that article for vetting them. Every step of the way, you're vetting them. And that, of course, does not guarantee your happiness in the job, but greatly increases your chances. Make sense? Most people do not vet that carefully. Any other questions? Yes. Sure. Why not? Again, that's empower. What? Screw them. They've put you through torture, all the fear of going in for the job, and then you go and do the interview, and you maybe screwed it up or didn't screw it up. Maybe you thought you did great, but they may not give it to you, unfortunately. They're always afraid of lawsuits, afraid of you arguing back. So very often say, well, I'm sorry, we just decided to go in another direction. Or they lie. Let's say they thought you were stupid. They're not going to tell you you were stupid. Well, we looked for somebody with a little more experience. You know? Somebody with a different, little different skill set. You know, so usually you don't get an honest answer about the things that are really central. You know? You sounded high maintenance. I won't tell you that. Then you'll fight back or whatever. They want to get rid of you. They want to get it. So if you have every right to ask, but if you're going to do it, you need to do it in a way that makes clear that you're not going to be giving them a hard time. So you word it like this. You say, well, first of all, if you said you screwed up, if you screwed up in the interview, you have a second chance of undoing it by in your thank you note. In your thank you note, you can write, you know, on reflection, I had some additional thoughts on that question you asked me about blah, and you write it out. That gives you a second shot. But we're talking about at the end, you didn't get the job, you're asking for feedback. You write a polite letter saying, I was very enthusiastic about the job because of blah and blah and blah, and of course was disappointed not to get it. But of course I want to keep growing like any good professional. So I'm wondering, as I look to other jobs, is there any feedback you might give me that might help me? So you're not trying to get a second bite at the apple, you're just trying to get some feedback. Okay. Will it always work? No. Will it sometimes work? Yes. Okay. Any other questions about the yes? You and then you.
I'm just wondering, and this is sort of a, I'm interested in working specifically for a nonprofit.
So is everybody in the Bay Area.
I'm sorry.
So is everybody in the Bay Area.
So is everyone, is right. So would you say this is sort of a one-size-fits-all kind of advice? This applies, or do you have specific advice for a nonprofit or,
Sure. There is tremendous suspicion in this country, but especially in the Bay Area, between the two sectors. If you've worked in the for-profit sector, they don't think you're sufficiently committed. And so if you're new to the nonprofit sector, you need normally to show some real evidence of your commitment, because they're going to ask you normally to work longer hours for less money. And so you need to talk about how you volunteered, or if you haven't, you need to volunteer, or that you're, you know, if you're trying to work for the Cancer Society, you know, that you lost your mother recently to cancer and it's really motivated you and realized that that's what you really want to focus on, whatever it is. So you need to show the unusual commitment if you want to work in the nonprofit sector. You also have, nonprofits are extremely collaborative in their decision. We talked about, you know, the job description that lists everything under the sun. Again, every organization is different, but nonprofits in general are extremely collaborative in decision making. They're very team-oriented. And so you need to show that you really are committed to that way of being. You know, bold initiatives, individual, bold action is not the way that most nonprofits work. But teams, collaboration, sharing, consensus. And so you need to show that you fit in that environment. I would hate to work for a nonprofit. I am absolutely a solo operator. That's just who I am. And so on. That's another point. I would say, and I wrote that in the second handout, I would say that up front. That will get me rejected from the wrong jobs and accepted for the right ones. I think I wrote in the second one, give me the hard problem, I'll do it myself on time and quickly and well. Put me on a team, I'll go nuts. And what that will do is, not only will it get me rejected from the wrong jobs, but then anything else I say positive about myself will be viewed much more credibly. Because I was acknowledging weaknesses. Yes, let's wait for the microphone. The need for the video.
So I'm going to switch the question around. I've been working in the nonprofit sector my entire career, and right now I work at one of the biggest nonprofits in the Bay Area, and I want out. I hope I don't know anybody in the room. So the challenge I have is making that change. I don't know where and or how to identify my passion and to get inspired again and find a job that'll feed me with.
Well, that's perfect.
Knowing what the bottom line is.
Why don't you be the first makeover? Why don't you come on up? Yes, let's hear it for her. Staircase is there if you want to be. Thank you. Great, thanks. So, would you mind telling us your first name?
Marla.
Marla. Okay, so tell me, you know you want to work in the for-profit sector, but...
I don't know if I want to work in the for-profit sector. I'll be straight up, I want to make more money.
Right.
Okay. You know, that's my reality. But I also want to work for an organization where I believe in the bottom line.
Okay. So tell me some clues about who you are, and then I'll ask you some questions. Tell me about your strengths, your weaknesses, your interests, what you say the bottom line. It sounds like you care about causes, you care about this. Tell me some clues about you so we can work from there.
I live by my heart. I'm very outspoken, very articulate, well-organized, love to travel. I like being in charge. I have a strong supervisor. I have patience.
I got that. So what kind? You could feel that. How many of you felt that already? Right? Right. Right. So what you said, you used the term bottom line, but I assume you meant by that, you meant causes.
Bottom line, definitely. I can't see myself working for an IT company or for a technology company. Right now I work for an organization where the mission is to cut poverty in the Bay Area, but their mission is so incredibly vast that it's hard to measure. So I would love to find an organization, whether it be nonprofit or for-profit, where that bottom line can be easily measured.
What if I said that you framed the question wrong? You can disagree with me. The reason you're not making more money is because you're impatient. You're strong, but maybe you're not a wise enough leader. Maybe you need to, I don't turn you into somebody who's just wishy-washy, but maybe you need to learn how to affect change in two ways. One is doing more to be able to motivate people, because I found myself even viscerally, it's like, I don't need a microphone, I have a loud voice. It was like already it's like you knew better than me before. There was something of a know-it-all quality that I think can get you in trouble and maybe why you haven't advanced into a higher level position. And so what if I say, and then the second component, apart from the people thing, is if you're working for a large organization that has a huge mission, the wise leader is very good about demarcating what he or she wants to focus on and takes on manageable projects that she can get wins on. So if you go find some other job, I'm wondering whether you're going to bring your problems with you and you still won't make all that more money, or if any. What if I said the answer really is to look in your current job and say, okay, I need to improve my leadership and communication skills, and I need to be smarter about politically negotiating a turf that is manageable. What feels right and wrong about that?
You hit the nail on the head. I mean, what you're telling me, I've heard before. I mean, I'm a development person for a nonprofit, so I'm a fundraiser. And my personality is perfect for that type of job. And what I do, I actually enjoy. But I have been told that I'm too assertive. So
it's not because you're a woman. A lot of times they use that thing.
Yeah. It's my personality, and it's not going to change. But I think a challenge I do have, this is really fascinating, you're really hitting the nail on the head, is that I don't know how to change in a way that works for me.
The way to do it is with video. Watching yourself, having these kind of conversations, and this, they're making a video, and it's going to be posted on YouTube, is that correct? You should watch yourself. You will see a million little things. Right. You will find a million little things. We make judgments on such subtle things, like what's called the latency period, how much time exists between when I finish talking and you start. If you jump right in, it says you don't respect me. It's making me feel one down. If you interrupt me, I probably feel even less so. And we know that East Coast people do it more. But this is California. And California's land of laid back. And
it's been 7 years since I've been used to it.
Right. Well, when in Rome, do like Romans. If you want to make more money, you can't say, I'm an East Coaster and I'm going to do it my way, So I invite you in terms of this 3-minute workover, rather than look for another job, look inward both at the communication style, how you motivate people, and whether the fundraising projects you're doing are the right ones. By the way, I know a lot of development people, and in fact, some of the best ones are very low-key. They never even make an ask. They develop a relationship with heavy hitters, and then it is the donor knows that you want money. And at the right time, they volunteer. So there's a lot maybe that you need to learn about even fundraising. What do you think?
A lot of food for thought.
There you go. Let's hear it for her. That's why I entitled this talk, Straight Talk. Thank you for what impressed me about you. You're open-minded. You didn't get defensive. That's awesome. That speaks, yes. That gives me much more optimism than most people who get defensive on the first little criticism. Yep. I think that's another good East Coast characteristic. I think we're more used to getting criticized and realizing as long as it was benevolently derived, it's the most loving thing you can do. Right. When somebody is, oh, you can do anything you want. You know, all that California nice, forgive my language, shit. that's being nice, but it's not being good. It's much more important to be good than to be nice. Who had a question? Right.
Hello, my name is Marisa, and I was a nurse for many years and went into clinical research for a pharmaceutical company. And I enjoy part of that job. I was clinical trial manager. I really don't like the other part. I'd like to get into the development part.
The other part, the record keeping, you mean, and the reporting
yes,
to the doctors?
Okay. Exactly. The detail-oriented part. So I would like to get into a job where I build the relationships and I maintain the relationships, but I don't have to worry about the details. I don't have a business degree, and that's where I run into trouble.
We're going to play a game.
Okay.
You ever been to the eye doctor?
Yes.
And get fitted for contact lenses or glasses?
Yes.
And they ask you, is it better with lens one or lens two?
Yes.
And after a while, you can't tell if you feel
yes.
stupid?
Exactly.
Right. So I'm going to give you simply two choices. You simply tell me which is better. And then eventually, we'll be narrowing in, like on the right. Lenses will be narrowing in the right. Okay. Would you rather be a discharge nurse in a hospital, or would you rather be the patient and family liaison in an assisted living facility?
Liaison. I just can't find a job doing that.
Okay.
Yes.
That exact thing in assisted living? Or just paid liaison?
A paid liaison.
Okay. Would you rather work as a phone nurse at Kaiser, an advice nurse, or would you rather be a customer service relations person for a health insurance company, talking to doctors, talking to providers, et cetera?
Second.
Okay. Would you rather...
I prefer face-to-face.
Okay, face-to-face. Would you rather be the nurse in an urgent care clinic, you know, those minute clinics like at Walgreens, or would you rather work for the insurance company as the liaison with doctors and nurses?
Second.
Okay. Now, let's create a Marisa meter. Marisa, you like Marisa rather than Marisa? Okay. Let's create a Marisa meter. Let's pick. I know everybody hates all insurance companies, but which one insurer would it be? Sutter? What would be the insurer? Kaiser would be the insurer you'd focus on?
I dislike all of them because
right.
their goal is different than my goal.
It sure as hell is.
Their goal is to
deny.
Get you out fast and deny.
I know.
So in reality, I wouldn't want to work for any of them. I would, but I... That's who's out there.
Would you rather be a patient advocate?
Yes.
Let's say somebody has been diagnosed with diabetes or cancer or mm-hmm. whatever, and they're going to be needing a lot of involvement. And let's say they're scared and they don't know how to work the system. Would you rather work for that insurance company, which will be more stable, or would you rather be the advocate, but you'd have to be your kind of self-employed person?
In reality, I would like to do the second part, but I enjoy the team atmosphere more. But personally, in my personal life, I have been the patient advocate and gone with friends and family members to the doctor's appointments and given them advice and be the pain in the neck to the doctor asking all the questions. But I don't think I'm a self-starter in reality. I know that about myself. I like a team environment.
Right. I believe that the only survivor in the next few years in the healthcare space is going to be Kaiser. The Obama administration and what will be either the Sanders or Clinton administration hates insurance companies and will do everything possible to put them out of business. And they'll just leave the... So the only player left will be Kaiser, and then it'll be single payer. So, absolutely, that's what's going to happen. And remember, as soon as the ACA, is the Affordable Care Act, has not kicked in yet. Kicks in next year, the system is already overwhelmed. And when you have all those millions of low-pay people getting covered, it's going to be unbelievable. And then, when comprehensive immigration reform occurs after Clinton or Sanders gets elected, that's going to be 12.5 million more high-need, low-pay people being covered by the same system. It's going to be overwhelming, and so he's going to say, well, we knew that, so that's why we're going to get the single payer. So I say that by saying that the smart move, if you like a team environment, is to work for Kaiser. And so what I advise you, there's many, many jobs you never would have thought of, whether it be patient educator, I'm trying to think about things that aren't huge details, patient educator, there are innovative programs that they do. You've done your CRO, clinical research organizations. Those are
the ones. Hired CROs. Okay. Yeah.
So you know about clinical trials.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, you know, while you don't want to do the details, you'd be good at recruiting, explaining the tests and the procedures and whatever. Play around the Kaiser website, okay, and see what kind of programs there are like that. And if, you know, these days everybody knows somebody who works at Kaiser. Chat with them. Tell them that what you like doing is you like the person-to-person contact, you're not much on the details, you do have a clinical trials background, and you'd like to work for Kaiser. Is there somebody you should talk with? Kaiser is such a behemoth. It's so large that you'll not likely get an in. Does that make sense?
Yes. I went to the JVS Center. I don't know if you're familiar
JVS
with it.
JVS is Jewish Vocational Services, yes. But they're open to everybody.
Everyone.
The Jews are the only people who take care of everybody but themselves, but that's another story.
And I attended a...
Oh, you know, you look at the poor Palestinians, they're all Jews. But anyway, I digress. Yes.
I attended a panel discussion of... And somebody there was from Kaiser. And I spoke to her afterwards, and she said, wow, with your background, there's so much you can do at Kaiser.
Exactly.
Problem is, I dropped the ball and didn't follow up with her, and it's been 6 months.
So what?
Call her out of the blue?
Of course, but it's not out of the blue. People are not, she's not waiting around hanging with bated breath waiting for your call.
Yeah.
Say, you know, I've now moved to the point where I'm ready to make a move, and I didn't want to contact you until I was.
Okay.
Here are my skill set. Who would you suggest I talk to? There's a rule I want to teach you. It's called, if you ask for a job, they'll give you advice. If you ask for advice, they'll give you a job. Because they don't want to feel the pressure. If I asked you, can you give me a job? You have any advice about what I might do? And if you happen to have had a job possibility, you would tell me about it. You ask for a job, they'll give you advice. Ask for advice, they'll give you a job. So you don't ask her for a job, you ask her for advice.
And lastly, two points actually. How do you stand out? Because there are so many qualified applicants out there right now, so you have to distinguish yourself. So how do you ask an intelligent question that isn't the run of the mill? And the other thing is, how do you know really that you will fit in and not highlight your negative aspect? I can't go and tell people I don't like details because there's details in every job. So how do I spin it?
You don't have to spin it.
I don't want to
what
spin
you're
it.
See in the rest
I want
of
to be authentic. But
well, you're going to see in throughout this, one of the themes is going to be radical honesty. You don't have to say, I hate details. But you can say, I mean, the truth, you're going to hate me for saying this. I want you to make believe you're the Kaiser employer. And you're, let's say, in HR, so there's many different jobs. And I look you in the eye and I say, here are my strengths. I'm very good at establishing rapport with people. I'm really good at explaining things clearly. I'm very reliable. People on my team love working with me. You know what? I'm shitty, and I would literally use that word because it feels more human. I'm shitty with a lot of details. So if a job requires a lot of details, you don't want me. But you want, if you want some other job, you want me. As I said, that's going to establish your credibility. It's going to get you rejected from the wrong jobs and accepted for the right ones. Radical honesty. The older I get, the more I believe that it is right for it. It's a no-brainer. It makes you more credible. It's right for the employer because they're getting to know who you are. It's right for the patients. It's right for the cosmos. For me to say, if I were looking for a job, I am a very judgmental guy. I don't do well working along people who are not really smart. I need to be with really smart people, but I mainly need to be by myself and working on my own. Anything involving writing or speaking, it will get done and done well. But you don't want me on a team, especially with people who are lackluster. Nobody would ever do that, but that's the best way for me to get a job that's right for me and right for the cosmos. Right for the employer and right for the cosmos.
Thank
so you want to know how to stand
you.
Out? That's how you stand out. But also,
okay.
You can stand out in a million other little ways. It's in being, it's all the doing the little things right. It's showing up 2 minutes early. It's being your best self. It's being a little more enthusiastic. I don't want you to be phony. We all have different levels of enthusiasm by nature. You want to be at the top of your range, not beyond. I don't want you to turn you into a New York Jew like me. Be near the top of your range. That's still authentic, but it is portraying your best self. Asking those good questions, doing your homework and learning a fair amount about the job and thinking about it. Writing a thank you letter doesn't say thank you. Thank you, that's just obligatory. But a thank you letter that says, it was a real pleasure talking with you because of blah and blah. And I'm gratified that you liked my answer to this. And I did have one other something, a piece of collateral with you. You were interested in my ability to write, so I'm including a writing sample. Each one of those things makes you a little better. And again, no guarantees, but that absolutely boosts your chances. And of course, having a relationship with somebody. She asked you to call, that's clear, that's an advantage. What I don't believe in, for most job seekers, is trying to build a new network. It takes too much time. By the time you build a network, you're going to be homeless. It takes time to build enough of a relationship. So it's wise to use your existing network, even if it isn't a very deep one. Not the LinkedIn ones. Those are a waste. Those shallow little LinkedIn connections, they won't go to bat for you. They might give you a courtesy referral or a... As I'll talk about later, we all have only a certain amount of emotional gas that we have in our job search before we burn out. We don't want to run out of gas before we get a job. If you spend a lot of time exploiting these shallow little LinkedIn connections, it's burning up a lot of gas and not getting any results. Every time you get rejected or ignored, it's burning up gas. So no, but use the people who you know who actually know you and like you. They don't have to be your best friend. But they have to know you and like you. Friends, family, haircutter, former coworkers, bosses, lovers. Thank you for laughing. Okay. Next question. Yeah. By the way, do you agree? I find lecturing is narcissistic. A lot of speakers love to lecture because they like to flap their lips. But it doesn't get to what the need of the audience is. By devoting so much time to answering questions and doing workovers, I feel I'm closer to where you are and where your needs are. How many of you are feeling good that I'm focusing on answering questions? Okay, great. Please ask your question.
My name is Carrie, and I'm curious about your thoughts. I currently work for a state agency, and I want to make a transition into the private sector. And I'm finding that difficult.
It is difficult because, again, I talked about that huge distrust that exists between the sectors. They think the people who work for the government, they think for the people who work for nonprofits are extremely cause-driven and very anti-profit. And so companies are very reluctant. People who work for the state, they think are lazy. And they took a state job because they knew you can't get fired unless you rape a child. So I think that's funny. But it's not literally true, but it's close to true. You can't get fired from a state job, basically, unless you're...
I can actually verify that. And I, what's frustrating for me is that I am not that person.
Right. And so what you've got, what I'm saying, when there are biases, for example, there are many black people who say that there's, you know, bias against blacks. But even to the extent that it's true, it's one, maybe two strikes against you, it's not three strikes against you. We all know blacks who maybe we had an initial, you know, negative predisposition to, because we know the crime rate among blacks is higher than whites. It'd be stupid to not have it. But as soon as they open their mouth, we see they're intelligent, respectful, whatever. So that black person has got a shot. It's the same thing. You know, baseball players with two strikes hit home runs. Same with you. You've got a strike or two against you in working for the state, but you don't have three strikes against you. It just means, you know, blacks have often said you've got to work twice as hard to go half as far. Well, you're going to have to work twice as hard to get that job in that first job in the private sector. So you need to prove in your, notice my energy level, right? It doesn't feel very tired or non-profit-y or burned out, right? Non-profit people are very laid back all the time. If you're wanting to work in the public sector, in the private sector, they want you to be energetic. So it comes, you can show that you're not the typical burnout state employee by with your everything from your tone of voice to the enthusiasm of your letter, to the fact that it doesn't have to be long, but it's going to be crisp with bullet points. And then in the interview, you ask smart for-profit-y questions. Where, you know, I noticed, for example, that your company is not invested in China. Was that a conscious decision, or that you felt the cost-benefit ratio was poor? You're using for-profit language. Can you see how even if you've got two strikes against you for working for the state, you sound like that, and all of a sudden, you got a shot at getting at least a base hit, if not a home run. Every step of the way, it really is like the black thing. You may have a strike or two against you, but you can still hit a home run. Next question. Let's get the microphone. Wait for the microphone.
It is doable to go from the state back into the private industry, because I actually did, I guess my state service was kind of in between my private and my current private, but it's doable, but you definitely have to get involved in the industry you're targeting or the company you're targeting, so you speak the language, you understand the industry, the people, the culture, everything is a factor. And whatever job you want to apply for, you have to make sure you present yourself as the most capable person for that job, for that company. You know, you're going to bring experience with you, but they want to see that you can literally live in the same environment that they live in.
You know what kind of job you would want in the private sector? What kind? Let's give it back the microphone.
I would like to move into recruiting.
Okay. Have you done that for the government?
I do it indirectly.
Okay. So you are going to have to make the case that you're great at recruiting. You haven't even done. So you have a second strike against you. You haven't. It's not like you did recruiting for the state. So what you need to do is, certainly your resume needs to highlight what kind of recruiting things that you did and put that in your resume. You need to have stories ready, called PAR stories, to tell examples of where you recruited. So in other words, a PAR story is a problem you faced, how you approached it, and the positive result. So the problem was, we were looking for a Ruby on Rails programmer who was willing to move to Sacramento and blah, 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 blah. And rather than the usual route, which is simply to place an ad on the state website, in addition to placing an ad on Dice, I happened to know six people who were in high-tech IT and got referrals from them, and we ended up hiring a rock star, da 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 da. And so that's the problem, how you approached it, usually the clever or dogged approach you used, and then the positive result. Each of those things boosts your odds. And if you have not had experience in doing recruiting, you at minimum need to write what I call a white paper. You can sometimes trump the lack of experience by writing a white paper, which is a 2 to 3 page equivalent of a term paper that would impress your target employer. So it would be, for example, if you're interested in doing recruiting in what space? The private sector is very big. Are you looking for packaged goods, high tech? What kind of recruiting? Healthcare?
Yes, probably more healthcare and admin.
Great. So you should write a 2 to 3 page paper called 7 Keys to Admin Recruiting in the Year 2016 and Beyond. You Google it, you find articles, you talk to recruit, you call recruiters for admins, you know, like Kelly Services or whatever. You get as much information and you distill it into an awesome 2 to 3 page white paper called 7 Keys or 6 Keys or 5 Keys to Recruiting in 2016 and Beyond, and you include that with your applications. That will show that you're current and up to speed. Will it trump having 3 years of experience? No, it won't. Does it give you a shot? Yes, it does. Because her point's right. You got to learn about your field specifically. More questions? Yeah. This guy in the back.
Speaking of the white paper concept, where would you publish that? In my industry, there's a lot of recruiting or job opportunities that come about because recruiters are out looking
Absolutely.
On the internet.
Well, it could be nowhere. It can simply be something you hand to them. But of course, it's better. Certainly, LinkedIn has something called Pulse, where you can publish anything you want on Pulse, and so you can simply post it there and then include a link to it with your job applications, or forums. There are forums in LinkedIn and Yahoo forums and in your professional associations. You can post your article on a blog and then a link from your blog to the forums in your professional association. There are very often magazines, trade magazines. I've had a CFO client who was laid off, and I asked him, one of the ways we could get access to other CFO level people would be to get a commission to write an article on CFO's predictions for 2016. So he went to CFO Magazine and say, I have been a CFO, currently unemployed, but interested in finding the lay of the land from some of the luminaries in the field. Will you let me write an article? And they said, well, you don't have really a track record, but I'll take it, I'll let you do it, and we'll see if I like it or not. Great. That was enough for him to have an assignment and be able to contact CFOs and say, I'm on assignment with CFO Magazine. I'm interested in talking to the luminaries in the field about your projections for 2016. He was able to get access to CFOs that he never would otherwise could have gotten access to. Now, I'd be lying to you if I said he got a job. The problem really was the technique is great. He just doesn't make that good an impression. He's a beat off. He doesn't quite get it anymore. I think some of it's age related. He just seems to not quite be on the money. And at that level, CFO level, you've got to be pretty sharp. And so it didn't work for him, I won't lie. But it's a great technique, a way of getting your thing published and getting access to people you otherwise never get. Clinical trials, nurses, projections about how the field will change in 2016. There must be a publication read by clinical, you know, by CROs and by pharma trial people. Get it published there, or it was simply on a forum online, you know, and it would be a magazine.
Good morning, Mr. Nemko. I appreciate the good work that you're doing in this field. Thank you very much.
I try.
My question is, I kind of know my strengths, but I don't want to limit myself to particular jobs or fields. How would I go about like finding a coach that does really good work on a cheap?
How about on the free? Come on up here.
On a free, yes.
Come on up.
All right.
It's interesting. I was waiting for somebody to, you know, if I were coming up, I would climb up here and be so nice and polite and walking around. And anyway, okay. What's your name?
Rudy.
Rudy. Okay. So you can't be open to anything. I know you know, because then you need to have some kind of. You don't have to be super narrow, because if you're super narrow, you're closing off too many options. But if you're all over the place, you sound desperate, and you won't know enough about any one thing to impress anybody to hire you. So let's come up with something that isn't so specific, but isn't all over the map either. Okay? So tell me some clues about you.
Sure. I like doing a lot of reading. I like synthesizing information, building new ideas, conceptualizing things. I don't like working with my hands as much, so machinery or artistic things of that nature. I find that I don't take a whole lot of risk. I like things to be stable and already figured out, kind of thing. Okay.
So what do you like to read?
I like to read a lot of books on psychology, social psychology, self-improvement, leadership, things that make you perform better in your life.
What have you done before? What kind of work have you done before?
Currently, I'm a mental health counselor in San Francisco.
Okay.
So I do a lot of work with making people better, giving them advice, suggestions in group settings, case management work, that kind of thing.
What's making you want to change from that?
It's just that I just feel like my worth, my knowledge, what I have to offer is just not being optimized. I mean, I have a master's degree and things of that nature, and I feel like I'm not getting the amount of money and the amount of challenge that I think I deserve and need.
And so let's look at that. There could be a couple of reasons for that. Is that because it's just dead end, there's just no opportunities in your agency? Is it your boss doesn't like you for irrational reason? Is that you've done something wrong and you could be doing more? If you were to look honestly in your soul, what do you think are the reasons that you haven't gotten more responsibility and money in your agency?
There's a couple of reasons. In the beginning, I was given opportunities by my boss to become the director at my job, but it wasn't the right time. I had other family obligations and I just couldn't do it. I was going to graduate school, so there was other things that was getting in the way. When I finally graduated and did the things that I did and my family situation changed, then I wanted to get those jobs, but they weren't there.
Great. I know you say you like writing, reading, and thinking and analyzing. Would you like a job similar to that? Because that would be the easiest for you to get because you've got a background that kind of lends itself to going there. Or do you want to do something completely different?
I want to combine a little bit of both. So a little bit of like stuff that I do now with people, because I feel like that's something that I'm really good at, is communicating and understanding people. But I also have like a desire to like do conceptual work, build new ideas, and further the field in certain it could be tech or something like that, but something that sort of like utilizes my ability to synthesize information and make new things.
You don't have a tech background. Why would you say tech?
Because that's one of the other fields that I've been finding myself getting more fascinated with. I don't have a tech background. I have a healthcare administration background and biology background.
What about technology is fascinating to you? What are your skills in technology?
Statistics, analysis. I have a background in statistical programming, but it's very limited. I mean, when I went to graduate school, it was like that.
So let's say we're going to create a Rudy meter. And the Rudy meter goes from 0 to 10. With 0 means the idea makes you puke, and 10 means it gives you an orgasm, okay? I do like when people laugh at my jokes.
I like that.
That's good, right? So the idea of you working for the state of California in program development and evaluation, because you've got some statistics background in the mental health space, developing programs and evaluating them, scores of what on the Rudy meter?
7.5.
What keeps it from being a 10?
My stereotypes.
Tell me more.
Stereotypes of once I get in that field, I just don't feel like I would be able to move up as far as I think I deserve.
Okay, so let's tweak that. Let's say it's now a company that provides mental health services. You know what an EAP is?
No.
Employee Assistance Program. Corporations hire these outside firms to provide counseling services, and they develop programs. Could be drug prevention programs, race relations programs, whatever. And then they develop and they evaluate them. But it's a company. What does that score on the Rudy meter?
It's probably closer to an 8.
What keeps it from being a 10?
Just don't have a familiarity with it.
Well, that's going to be true of anything I'm going to mention to you.
Sure.
Is there something you have familiarity with that could score higher than an 8?
let's see. I guess the current work that I'm doing now with some of the counseling and using ideas to like benefit people, like, you know, non-traditional ways of thinking and looking at problems.
So are you saying that the problem is not the right, is not the job, but the agency? What if you simply look for a parallel job where there may be a bigger top, where there may be more ability to do instead of just the one-on-one, where you have a seat at the table in program development evaluation? So maybe you don't need a career change at all. Maybe you just need a change of location, a change of jobs. Does that feel right?
That feels like about a 9.
9. What keeps that from being a 10?
I don't know.
let's take a moment. Think about it. What keeps that from being a 10?
Perhaps not enough money.
And if I said that there are two, if that's the right job, the after-tax difference, you know, remember, if you're going to be getting more of a seat at the table, you're going to be making somewhat more money. Mm-hmm. And anything above that is going to be taxed at your highest rate because taxation is what's called progressive. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be taxed at 28 or 35% federal, another 8 to 11% state. So the actual after-tax difference is not that great. You shouldn't worry so much about that. You should go for the job that you're going to do well at. It's going to be a little more intellectually stimulating and not just one-on-one patient care, client care. And if you need more money, maybe at some point you could do some kind of fun, some other, no, let me just do this one. Would you, if there was a little, if you wanted additional money, would you rather, you're very verbal, so would you rather teach a class to make a few extra bucks? Or would you rather do something completely different to make a few extra bucks?
I'd rather teach a class.
What would you teach a class in that you think people would pay something for?
how to solve your problems and novel new ways and challenging ways, how to challenge yourself, how to improve yourself.
So if I say what I want you to do is I want you to go to the adult school, the head of the adult school in your wherever you live, and offer to teach a class. They pay about $25 an hour, and you make a point of teaching one class every semester, so you're making a few extra bucks. It's providing a little pizzazz in your life. Mm-hmm. And you also look for another agency where instead of just doing the one-on-one, you may have more of a seat at the table to use your program development analysis and evaluation and statistics skills. How does that feel as a plan?
A 10.
Let's hear it for him. All right.
Thank you. You're good.
Okay, cool. Yes. Let's wait for the microphone to come to you. By the way, before we get to her, was there any lesson in what I did with him that applies to you? Want to say again? Don't give up. Anything else? Tell me what you mean. Clarifying stereotypes, tell me what you mean. Okay, what else? Anything else? Could be. The biggest lesson in that, career change is very hard. He wants more money. He's going to make a career change, and this is the kind of no-nonsense talk that I like to give. In general, they pay you less money to do something new. They're going to pay you more to do what you do, what you have experience in. And because of that, as well as very often, as with the first person who came up here, what's needed is not necessarily a career change, but a tweak, either a different employer in the same field, or as in her case, internal changes. So before you run to a new career, realize you're probably going to make less money in the new career, and you may very often bring your problems with you. So your first step should be to look inward and say, how could I change myself or my job description in my current job? Let's say you're somebody who is more of this people person, who likes to interact with people, and you're spending all this time detailed writing the reports on each patient's, you know, when they showed up, what their blood pressure was, all the rest of this crap. See if you could trade, because your job description trade, you know, maybe to somebody else who loves the details and who hates all the interpersonal stuff. See if you can trade assignments with them or somehow change your job. Let's say you're bored. You've been doing this same job for a million years, and you're sick and tired of it. Think of a cool project. What if you're a dancer and you're an accountant? What the hell does dancing have to do with accounting? Well, what if you decided that you were going to put on, instead of the usual picnic, we're going to have a dance, or we're going to have a talent show. Do something to add juice to your job that isn't as much of a pain in the ass as trying to change careers. So change yourself, change some little aspect of your job, add a little cool bonus to the job, or look to change employers but stay in the same field. Those are a lot easier than deciding that you are an admin and in the state, and now you want to become a recruiter for a company. Those are tough sells. Because although the unemployment rate is 5.2%, for any decent job, they get a zillion applicants because there's so many jobs that are part-time, temp, contract. So if it's a decent job, they're getting a zillion applicants and not going to take a newbie. Unless they decide they're going to get a newbie and they're going to pay him or her shit, which you don't want anyway. So before you, you know, obviously if you've got a terrible job, terrible boss, whatever, unethical, then you've got to leave. Fine. But think about tweaking before dumping your job. Question? Great question? Oh, you, right, yes.
Oh, me?
Yeah, you have the microphone.
Yes, I do. Hi, I'm Danielle. So I have reached a career plateau. I'm currently a nanny, and this is certainly not where I envisioned I would be 10 years ago when I graduated with a Bachelor of Science in Biology. Since I was a little girl, I had always envisioned that I would be a doctor. I went to medical school. I left halfway through because of personal issues. And then I spent a few years after taking care of family members. And then I kind of fell into nannying because I wanted to be a pediatrician initially, and I love children. And now I'm not quite sure how to make a transition into something that I would actually enjoy doing. And
I said you should go, you should become a physician assistant. There will be tremendous, as for the reasons I outlined, there will be an enormous demand for physician assistants. There'll be a six-figure salary and specialized in peds. You know, pediatric physician assistant. It's not that long a training program. You can start at a community college. So the actual cost of training is not like being a doctor is crazy. It's I teach at UCSF Medical School. It's $300,000. That's a public institution, $200,000. $200,000 for a medical degree. That's crazy. Go be a PA, specialize in peds. You've already taken a lot of the coursework. They have programs for people who already have bachelor's degrees that may be a shortcut in. Where do you live?
Walnut Creek.
Walnut Creek. I only know about one program, but there's many. Look through Google PA, physician assistant programs, and then the word Foothill, because I know Foothill down in Mountain View has a great PA program. But by Googling that, you'll probably find the names of others. If you're lucky, something like Diablo Valley or some East Bay one will have it. But I'm not saying you should do that. I'm curious as to your reaction to that.
I'm fearful.
Tell me more.
I had never seen.
You know what? Let's get you up here. Come on up. We are going, just for those of you who are crossing your legs, we will be taking a break in 10 minutes. She's polite.
I'm not too. Coming up. I'm coming up the stairs too.
Yeah, she's got short legs. We excuse her. Sort of Rudy, actually. Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be a big jump for me.
Yeah, that's funny. Right. Okay. So fear. What's the fear?
Before I left medical school, I'd never failed at anything before, and it was really hard for me to leave medical school and to be like, well, my personal issues are making me leave, not because I had failed all my classes.
But let's say medical school is ridiculously hard for no reason.
It's insane.
It happens to be, because I do teach in the medical school, I know. It's scary, and the more prestigious the school, the more ridiculously hard, what I call it's irrelevant hard. You've got to memorize 100 hormones. Shit you'll never need to know in your whole life, masses of it, in the era of the internet, when so much of it is available. And they spend little time on real, I shouldn't say this on video. they don't spend enough time, in my judgment, on doing differential diagnosis and treatment. So I don't want you to think you're not good because you can't learn irrelevant hard shit. I'd rather, in a PA program, it's going to be more practical, less theoretical. It's not taught at UCSF now. You'll find, I think you will succeed. If you are good enough to get into medical school, you will succeed as a PA. And, you know, this is going to sound crazy, but I profoundly believe you can learn a lot about a person by looking. Remember I said after 40, this is a kind woman. I feel this is a kind woman. In your heart of hearts, do you believe you're a kind woman?
Yes, that I know. I didn't actually know, on the flip side, I didn't know I was intelligent until I left medical school, which I think is astounding.
Why didn't
you? I think that speaks a lot.
Yes, it is. Tell me more about that. Hold the mic a little closer to you.
Sure.
You knew most people can't get into medical school. You had to take all that organic chemistry, inorganic physics, and biology. You got. Why did you not think you were smart, even though you could get into medical school?
I think that stems just to the kind of person that I became just growing up.
Why? Why did you become? Was it your daddy, your mommy? Or was it your peers? Were you ridiculed for being short? What was the deal?
Oh, please. I knew that was coming. Yeah, the short thing, I knew it was coming from my family. But yeah, no, it's predominantly just a nature, you know, nurture thing, more of a nurture thing.
Be specific. What made you lack? Here you were, this bright woman, bright enough to get into medical school. What happened in your childhood to make you feel like you were a loser?
My parents?
Say more.
So I grew up in a household where, you know, you don't take geometry when you're in fifth grade, but I got a 98. This is the kind of household I grew up in, so I got a 98 on a geometry test, and it was like, where are the other 2 points with expletives? So that's the kind of household I grew up in.
And so, how old are you now?
32.
You're 32. Is it time, and again, forgive anybody, I hope people are not offended by me. Anybody offended by my cursing? What if I said it's time to say fuck you to your parents? You know, not in toto. I want you to forgive them. But I want you to say fuck you to the message that you are a loser. You were smart enough to get into medical school, damn it. You're not shackled. Sometimes people, especially if they've gone to a lot of therapy, they keep fanning the flames of what their mother and father did, and it makes it worse. I'm going to be tough. Grow up. It's time to not be saddled by childhood messages. It's sad that you'd be a nanny. Nanny is wonderful, but you can't make a living.
Yeah. No, I can't. I want to make money. I want to have a family.
You have to make a living. You have to be a normal.
Especially in this area. How am I going to buy a house?
Right. So it's time to say fuck you to the message that you are inferior or not smart enough and take deep breaths and baby steps and become a PA and be a loving and kind PA to children. And I believe in my soul that you could do it. You believe me when I'm saying that?
Mostly.
What part of you doesn't? Please be honest. That's the most important thing.
I have a lot of years of insecurity to shake.
Make believe I'm you. And I say, I have a lot of years of insecurity to shake. What's your advice to me?
Oh my goodness, I'd probably be your biggest cheerleader. I know what I'm like when I speak to other people, even strangers on the street, you know? So.
What's the smartest way to put aside the insecurities? I have insecurities too.
Just do it. That's usually the smartest way.
Can we have a little round of applause for just doing it? Okay. Yeah. Cool. What a great time to take a break. So we're going to take a 15-minute break. And the reason it's a little long is two things. Afterwards, I'm going to stab. Do I have to get kicked out of here at 1 o'clock? Huh? Yes. So, okay. So, what I'm going to do is this. I forgot. Am I allowed to sign books or no? No? No.
Well, is that a problem? We're not really set up for it.
Never mind. Okay, don't worry about it.
During the program?
No.
Before 1 o'clock?
Okay. Yeah, that's what I was going to do. I was during the break. I was just going to sign books.
Oh, and during then, the break. Yeah.
Is that right? And then at 1 o'clock, can I do the piano thing?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So afterwards, I like to say this. I saw, as I was walking down here, I saw a piano. I never met a piano I didn't like. I wrote it has no words, but I wrote a piece of music that kind of describes the typical process of my clients, my career counseling clients. They come in scared, sad, quiet, typically. And then they slowly make progress and then get a nice big breakthrough, and then they end up resolving things and being peaceful again. So any of you who wants, when I'm done, I will play that for you out on the piano that's right outside. Okay. You see, there are ways to build the creative side of who you are, whether it's dancing or writing or whatever, into even career counseling. Who would have thunk? Who would have thunk it? Okay, so my book is How to Do Life, What They Didn't Teach You in School. A third of it is about career, but other is it's about my best advice about relationships, money, meaning of life, health, everything. It's designed really to be like this little black book that keep with you through life with some not obvious but helpful tips. So it's only 10 bucks, and I will sign them here. So 15-minute break, 13 minutes. It's now 11:27. At 11:40, we start.